Wait, I just need a second.
Oh, shit. Smeared his feces.
Maybe I shouldn't say that.
Hello, I'm Sarah Paulson.
Mildred Ratched. I didn't ask what your name was.
Once I read it, I just thought, oh shit, now I'm gonna have to do this. Because, you know, as often happens with Ryan, is the more he talks to you about something, the more possible it all seems. And, you know, I just took the bait.
He was like getting his mic put on and he was like, Finn, can you come over here? And sort of just gave me like the bare bones pitch. But there is no better person in Hollywood to give you an elevator pitch than Ryan Murphy.
I can't rest until I know he's dead.
He took me out to lunch and told me that he was writing a part for me. So I was kind of like, let's hear it.
Ryan sort of leaned back to me and he's like, hey, I'm working on the second episode of Ratched. Would you write the cold open? That's Edmund's murder of the priests. And then just never stopped writing it. I thought I was coming to literally do like 10 pages and ended up doing most of the show.
I think we all kind of thought it would be a little closer to the source material, but then it became this really surprising, exciting departure from the original. You know, it's taking Ratched kind of out of that world and putting her into her own world.
You are reverse engineering a story here, so you know where it ends for her, at least in terms of like where audience's knowledge of her ends. And we're going backwards, and so you don't have to do everything that Louise Fletcher is doing because she hasn't become that woman yet. And so I thought, what can I bring that is something she's doing? And you know, part of the genius of her performance is that she reveals so little, and that's what's so compelling about it. But what I did notice is that she carried her keys up on her arm. And I would then wear it in some scenes. Once I was head nurse up here, sometimes I would hold it in my hand, but it was my homage to her.
A new day is dawning on the science of the human mind. All over the world, astounding new techniques are emerging that repudiate everything we thought we knew.
Why this time period is interesting, it was sort of at like the birth of even the notion of sort of like psychopharmacology and psychiatry. Those were new words and a new world.
You know, we're talking about mental health, we're talking about all of the things that drive people to go crazy. And it's always a big step to jump off the cliff to that sort of madness as an actor. And if you don't do it fully, I feel that it doesn't imbue the character with the danger, the legitimate danger that you should feel.
There's this book, might be back here, that my mom actually gave me. It's called The Boy Who Was Raised as a Dog. And it's this child psychologist interviews all these kids who have had really rough childhoods and sort of explains a child's point of view of what kind of abuse does to the brain.
And then I have to say the research sort of stopped because I thought I don't want to become so hyper familiar with the state of the mental health care system at that time in our country's history, because Mildred herself is not a nurse.
God bless you, Father.
Scene I do in Dr. Hanover's office was the very first scene I filmed. It was just a brilliant way to start because it's like a 5-page scene. I get there, Michael, the director, says, here's this huge space, which I'd imagined in my mind was going to be like a small like psychiatrist's office. And of course it's Ryan Murphy's world, so it's like an office the size of a ballroom. And he said, you can do what you want, you can go anywhere.
The first scene where Mildred and Gwendolyn meet in the nurse's lounge, and Gwendolyn is immediately interested in her and basically invites her on a date.
How about you let me show you around?
I'm sorry?
No, we are leaving.
You're not in charge here anymore, sir.
This patient admitted herself to this hospital, and she's free to leave whenever she chooses.
Sophie and I could not stop laughing when we were working together. We had a really hard time keeping, when I think about it, there's this one moment in the show where Dr. Hanover is trying to leave with her and I stopped them. And we had to do it where I had to kind of look at the wall behind her. We just really couldn't look at each other because we made the mistake of goofing off in between.
She really makes me laugh. She's very naughty, actually. She is actually very naughty on set. I'll just let you into that secret. And then she can sort of get it together and then you're left laughing.
It's amazing. She can crack a joke and then go into it so quickly. And sometimes you're like, wait, I just need a second to get back there. There's a scene sort of towards the end when I'm telling her about the barnyard and everything. And at the end of that scene, it ends with like, I can't wait to tell you about my new friends or something. And Sarah improvised, oh, tell me. And like totally put me on the spot, you know?
Like what?
Well, there's a cow.
A cow.
And a goat.
And, what kind of goat?
It became this like lovely little moment that was totally her invention.
Ryan said, I don't want this to look anything like One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest, and I don't want it to be down and dirty and gritty like that. I want it to feel like a glamorous hotel.
I just can't get over the sets.
You're like, woof, I better, you know, I walked onto that set for the first time and I was just like,
the hallways had like a sheen to them and like you had to go up and like look at it and realize that they actually did a thing that was period, but where you would wallpaper the walls and then paint over wallpaper, which I just never seen. But like that kind of detail.
Technically, in scenic terms, that's called movement. How much movement do you want in the plaster? Which means how much bumpiness.
Usually in a set that is built, everything is done just like as if it would never be done in a real old building. They'd like, you know, take an opportunity to make it look just perfect. But in the floor, if you look on the show, I thought this was so brilliant of Judy Becker to have done. The floor is not even, it's like rippled.
If it didn't have that kind of detail, I think it would look like a huge set. I like things to be based in reality as much as they can, because when you start to go off in an imaginative direction away from reality, it's good to have that fundamental basis that grounds the audience.
It just makes it really feel like an old building, and that was a set on a soundstage at Fox. I give the credit to all of them, and I just walked on and was like, holy shit, this is incredible. I better figure out what I'm gonna do in this scene now, because this set really deserves something to happen.
Looking good today, Mildred.
But at the same time, the costumes.
We got to explore something different with every character, you know, between the men and the women and the monkey.
Whether it's my kind of eccentric headpieces and dead animals, and you see how each person has their own way of being dressed that accentuates the mood of their characters are so beautiful.
Sharon's character, Lenore, her mansion, it's very saturated. The first few times we see her, we obviously don't want to lose her in that setting. So we purposefully went in with this cream white, you know, very light color palette so that she really popped.
And if I can add to what Rebecca was saying, if you were finished.
I am.
Okay. Like when Ratched arrives the first time in that strong gold suit, she walks in and you cannot deny her presence.
Lou, what's your favorite?
Do I have a favorite costume of the show? I would say it might be the Sharon Stone green dress with the necklace and the monkey. It's hard to say because, no, I don't. I have to, I'm retracting my statement. I don't have a favorite. I can't.
I'd like to have a room, please.
So there's a lot of trickery and a lot of arts and crafts that are happening behind the scenes. This happens to be a super heavy wig show, so we needed to do all of this pretty far in advance to have the wigs made.
The monkey was always there, like putting his hands in her hair, like in that wig. And so it was a whole thing of like going up and being like, oh, it's a monkey and I'm doing her touch-up. And the monkey loved the wig and
Natalie was always like, oh, it's okay, let's not touch the wig.
The favorite scene I shot, I don't think is in the series. We have a tea party and the monkey has, in this scene, smeared his feces all over the wall of the room. And we're having a conversation and I'm telling the monkey what I think and the monkey's picking up his dress and showing me his butt. It was hilarious.
I noticed a fairly prominent side effect.
You know, I had a fake penis in this scene. Like, that was a first. Like, and it did me justice. I mean, it was definitely a compliment, I'll say that. You know, but like, if you have a fake part of your body, like, someone has had to create and craft that. And of course, this crew had like three different options.
Yeah, I just ran across that in my storage unit. So it was like a box of them. So I was like, what's in this box? Oh, I'm gonna take this back to Fox because it can live at Fox. I don't need it to be at my house.
It's really true that Ryan's world is a unique world because so many people have worked together before. You know, they know that the actors have come along, but the same costume designer has been with him for years and years, and production designer, and that just creates like an ease and feel like you're just in the company of people that are gonna take care of you.
What is the difference about working on a Ryan Murphy show? I'm gonna have to have Rebecca answer that, in that I have worked with Ryan for 20 years. So I don't know what it's like out in the real world. Is there another world out there?
Well, it was Ryan really who wanted me to have the experience of executive producing for the first time. He just was sort of like, this is the next step for you and you should have that. And I think Ryan's one of those people, he knows he has all the cake, so he's not afraid to share it.
Okay, ladies. Let's hit the road.
Goodbye,
Rebecca.
Bye, Rebecca. Bye, see you later.
Goodbye.
Goodbye.
Don't fence me in. Let me ride through.